Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the first ever Bulletproof for BJJ podcast. Well, I'm super hyped. I'm trying to contain it just so that my enthusiasm doesn't explode the levels on the computer. But actually, the truth is Joe started Bulletproof for BJJ. And this is something that people may not know.
It's true. This journey is mine and I brought you along for the ride.
True. I'm just the backup dancer. So what I thought would be really good today, just for everybody who comes across Bulletproof for BJJ, to understand where you're coming from, Joey, and why you started Bulletproof for BJJ.
Cool. Yeah. So I guess a little background on me. I've been training jits for 12, 13 years. I'm a brown belt, got a few stripes on that thing. Been up and down with it over the years. Had my initial academy, got to brown belt with them. Wasn't really enjoying it by the time I got there. You know, the politics and the climate in that gym and blah, blah, blah. So when I got my brown, I was kind of at the end of my tether, you could say. Like, I'm just not enjoying going to training each night. And at the same time, I had just opened my first gym, Jungle Brothers, with, you know, two mates. And so there'd been this sort of thing where I was transitioning careers into being a personal trainer, opening a gym, got my brown and was like, I'm out.
Yep.
I'm just going to focus on the business, because really it's, you know what it's like, right? When you're super busy with your work, it's really hard to train jits every evening as well and whatever. So I took a big break and I focused on the gym, and the gym was strength and movement and mobility and all that stuff. And I went super deep on that stuff. And it was really cool because I had a couple of years where I was training like a savage in that realm, and it taught me a huge amount. But there was always this connection to jiu-jitsu, and there was always a desire for me to get back to it. But I had friends in the game. You know, by the time you're at like a higher belt, you got such a community around you, right? Whether it's friends or acquaintances or people you're doing business with, you know they're jiu-jitsu folk. So
it's kind of like Fight Club.
It's just like a Fight Club, right?
you see a guy, walk in, you're like, nod.
He's got a gnarled face. Yeah. That's my guy.
Cauliflower-y.
Yeah. So in any case, I was like, well, there's a real crossover here. What I'm doing in the gym and what I'm seeing with these jiu-jitsu guys and what I know of my own experience with jiu-jitsu, I can help these guys. And it started with just this desire to do something to help the jiu-jitsu community. So we at Jungle Brothers, Tiora and I decided to run a workshop that was called Bulletproof Bodies for BJJ. Right. And it was just a workshop. And it was like, here's a collection of the best shit we do in terms of strength training and mobility, real simple stuff that we're doing that jiu-jitsu people at large don't know about. And so we invited everyone we knew, we ran this workshop, and there was about 30 people there, mostly awesome guys. And that was the beginning of it.
Nice.
Yeah.
That's so cool. Right. Well, man, that's really cool. I actually didn't know that myself. So I'm learning right here, right now.
You're doing something parallel at this time, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, look, I think, I started jiu-jitsu, what was it? It was like early March in, say, 2008. And even then, because I kind of, you know, had come from being a PT and having a strength conditioning background, I was so blown away at how little that was in the world of jiu-jitsu. Like, I would like start stretching at the end of class and people were like, what are you doing? Just like shaming me. It's just like, I don't know, just trying to work on my flexibility, man. And then I trained kettlebells for about a year by the time I came to jiu-jitsu. And the crazy thing was, like, it had made such a difference on me in 1 year because there's so much grip and so much core training. I was like, wow, coming from taekwondo, I actually was pretty well prepped. It was kind of strange, even though I'd just done lots of kicking and punching and couldn't do any of it. Doing the kettlebell training had really changed my kind of, I guess, athletic profile. So for jits, I was like, oh, kettlebells is really good for jiu-jitsu. And then there's so many injuries. That's the thing. I was just seeing everybody super injured. And I got a lot of injuries too, just being a super keen, frothy, white belt, blue belt, just going too hard.
Of course.
As you do.
You just train through them, right? You're in your 20s.
Well, I don't know about train through them, but yeah, definitely it was like tape it, take the drugs, keep going.
Yeah.
And then going to Brazil and getting exposed to that, because I'm like, oh, this is the home of jiu-jitsu, right? But in truth, at that time, like, the training was, like, CrossFit wasn't even a thing really then.
No.
But what I had noticed is, because I've been to Brazil 5 times now, that each time I'd go back to Brazil, people would be doing different training. And, but that said, no one was really saying, hey, you need something which is actually going to, like, unwreck your body from jiu-jitsu.
Yeah.
Like, guys were like, I do CrossFit because CrossFit's hard and jiu-jitsu's hard, so that works. But then guys were, like, tearing their hands. They were overtrained and they were getting more injuries when they were doing jiu-jitsu. But because the mentality is that everyday pull harder and grind and, you know, even though that's super admirable in terms of, like, having a tough mentality, it doesn't speak to longevity or, like, being able to follow that path, because it's a pretty long path, right? Like, you and I have trained jiu-jitsu a similar amount of time. Obviously, I'm the black belt, Joe's the brown belt. We just established that early on.
Hey.
No privilege here. No black belt privilege here. But I mean, Joe should be a black belt, but he owns a gym. I own nothing because I'm a Buddhist. But essentially...
I'd give it all away in a heartbeat for a black belt.
The black belt's coming.
All of it.
Just keep it. Just keep it. You're going to get it. It'll be there. You don't need it. All right, sign over your gym to me right now. We'll do a trade. I think what was interesting is because I had people come to me and say, have you heard of this guy? This guy called Joe? Man, he's your brother. He does kettlebell training and personal training. And like, man, he does jiu-jitsu. He's a blue belt. Do you know him? I'm like, no. I've never heard of this guy. Like, who's this guy? And then, I don't know, I think maybe there was a similar thing on your end. Maybe someone has said, have you heard of this?
Dude, totally.
Who's this guy?
Yeah, people are like, man, you know that guy, James Tomlinson from Melbourne? I'm like, no, they're like, man, he's super into kettlebells. He's a blue belt as well. He's about your size. You guys look the same. I'm like, fuck, no.
How could anyone look like me? That's what Joe thought.
He looks
no
this
one's
good.
This handsome.
and that kind of went on. There's like a tale of this guy from Melbourne. And then I think, was it the Pan Packs?
It was Abu Dhabi Trials.
Abu Dhabi Trials.
And that was actually a little bit of political background. That was when your friend from the dojo he came back from Japan with a black belt and Paolo slapped him.
Oh, I wasn't there for that.
Oh, goodness.
I think you got a mix. Yeah, I wasn't there for the slap.
Oh, okay.
I was in Brazil at the time.
Oh, okay. All right. Because I was at that comp and that was like,
oh, shit.
It's going down. It's the closest you could get to like kind of backyard fights at a jiu-jitsu.
Everyone's like, hang on a second. We're not actually meant to be fighting guys' stuff. It's just a sport.
Just hug. Make up. Strangle each other. But yeah, I do remember it was at Sydney Aquatic Center, I believe, where someone went, I think it was like Eric Mastro or it was somebody who said, hey, man, stay here. I'm going to go get Joe. He's here. And went and like grabbed you. And I kind of saw you walk over and I was like, who's this guy?
Who's this dude?
And then it's kind of like sometimes when you see animals confront a mirror.
They're like flexing a little bit. Not really sure.
Not sure. Bit uncertain.
Bit anxious. Yeah.
It's like, oh, this face feels familiar. Oh God. And there's a point of recognition. Like there's a similarity here. It's a bit weird.
No words were exchanged for a good 5 minutes. It was just smelling, observing, sort of flexing.
It's interesting because I think for a couple of years, we kind of had just met up. I'd come to Jungle Brothers when it was at the original location.
Yeah.
When you were down in Melbourne, we kind of caught up for a beer.
And Vietnamese.
Vietnamese, of course. And at this time, Joey was trying to teach me to be more mindful. Actually, we did something which was quite meaningful. It made me like Joe. There's not a lot of things that make me like Joe other than, his similarities to me. But we went for, maybe it was Thai, just down from the old JB spot.
Oh, yeah.
And I was really in a rush. I mean, I was super caffeinated, as always. And
JT gets caffeinated.
I've dialed it down. Only a gram a day now. And we went to this restaurant and you said, no, man, like, I was like, should we get takeaway? Like, I'm going to have to go back to the Blue Mountains and go to the airport. And you're like, no, man, like, let's sit down. Let's just take this time. And it was almost like a mindfulness practice. You're like, let's think about this food, man. Like, let's smell it and eat it. And you did this thing. And I was like, wow, that's exceptionally cool. It was very memorable for me. It just sat in my mind. I was like, wow. Even though like that, these are different things that I've worked on since, within everyday life, we don't practice these things.
Yeah.
And it was great. And I was like, you know what? I could work with this guy.
I guess if you had to sort of mark the time, you would say that was the moment that I became the teacher and you became the student.
It's when we started training jiu-jitsu together. Sure. Like, that's fine. I mean, you know, so, you know.
From that day on, he called me sensei.
Sure. We can say that. I'll make that concession right now. And then we started training jiu-jitsu. Actually, I remember the first time we ever trained jiu-jitsu was at the dojo.
Yeah.
And it was one of the hardest roles I ever had. I couldn't sweep the guy. I couldn't submit the guy. I was like, is this what it's like to fight myself? Yeah. I mean, this is terrible. You're this strong, flexible, athletic guy. And it sucked because I was so used to having that advantage over people. I didn't have that advantage. And I was like, this is hard.
I think we still deal with that, don't we? Where it's like, it catches you by surprise. You're like, oh, fuck.
This usually works.
Normally when I put someone's hips there, they're fucking dying, but you're comfortable.
Frustrating. So, but I feel like when I think about Bulletproof for BJJ and the problems that we've recognized in the community, we have similar views on how, what we can do. And I think I was the one who said, hey man, we're doing similar things. We should collaborate. Like, I think there would be a strength in us working on a thing.
Yeah, I remember you came to Sydney because JT was living in Melbourne and you were coming to see your parents live here.
Yep.
Out of town. And so you'd come to Sydney and it'd always be like, I'm going to be in Sydney on this weekend. I'm out at the, you know, with mum and dad, but I'll be able to catch up for like a few hours on this day. So we're always just piecing together these little catch ups, usually around food, always around coffee. And I remember we're hanging out at Randwick near my place. We're walking through the park and you were like, yeah, bro, you're doing mad things. I'm doing mad things. We need to collaborate on something.
Yes.
And it was like, yeah, 100%. We're trying to help the same community. We have the same message. How do we do it? Mm. And we sort of didn't really know. We just knew we wanted to do some work together to help the Jits community.
Yeah, I think of it as rappers forming a rap group, something like that. Something very far cooler than our middle class white boy upbringings. But no, I think about it. And because the thing is like we do have different links in different communities. I, you know, have
Cuban links.
Cuban, only built for Cuban links. Word is born. And like my community is Melbourne. Shout out, Absolute MMA Melbourne, Lachlan Giles. You heel hooking mother upper. Also, Livia Giles, congratulations to both of you. They will be
having a little baby
child. Yeah.
Congrats, guys. It's awesome.
Beautiful thing. And yeah, and obviously, Joe having his strong connections in Sydney scene. With our powers combined, we are Captain Bulletproof. And I think I had made a decision when I turned 35 that I wanted to be less competitive and more collaborative because I feel like there's greater strengths in that. And I just could see what you were doing. And I was like, that's really awesome. And also Jungle Brothers, and I'm so grateful to be here now. Shout out Jungle Brothers for letting us use your mic equipment. Respect. It's always been the coolest gym I've ever been at. And the community here is amazing. So I kind of wanted to be a part of that as well as create a community because jiu-jitsu is a great community, but when you get injured, you feel alone. Like when your knee is hurt, you can't go to jiu-jitsu, you got to go to the physio, you know, you're in pain. And often when you're in pain, you feel alone. And I mean, you've had your own kind of, you know, ACL reconstruction and dealing with that. It's a confronting thing when you're injured.
It is. And I think I call it a flaw. It's not an intentional thing, but one of the problems with the jiu-jitsu world is that when someone gets injured, the jiu-jitsu community, so let's say like your gym, your coach, your team, they don't know what the fuck to do about it. Mm. So it's like, oh, just keep showing up, train light, or just do the technique, or sit off to the side and watch. Mm. There's like these very general kind of, you know, lukewarm suggestions, but there's no actual like, hey man, let's get you doing a rehab thing. Let's keep you connected with the community. Let's give you like, let's, let's reduce the price of your membership and like get you working in here outside of classes to fix your leg. Let's call you at 6 weeks to see if you're ready to cut. Like all these little things that are like, that a real community is like touching base with you and sort of facilitating your repair.
Yeah.
Doesn't happen.
Mm.
So, I mean, I think the stats show, and I'm sure most people can identify with this, a lot of the time people get injured in jits and then they take some time off and then they never come back.
Yes.
And then the coach forgets about them because they're busy coaching everyone else who's in their class in front of them.
Mm.
There's very little attention paid to that. So, there's like a... You really lose touch with the community when you cop an injury.
Yeah, and I know for myself, my mental health drops when I get injured, because then you can't do the thing you love, right? So then that has its negative effect, not only the fact you're in pain or you're isolated, but the truth is so many people in the jiu-jitsu community are getting injured.
Yes.
So you're not alone. You're actually part of the part of the greater group.
Welcome to the real club.
Yeah, that's right, the injury club, right? Yeah. And I guess the thing that I had thought, which is really what Bulletproof is built on, is being able to give those answers and give a path back. Because physios don't know. You go to a physio, you're like, I was upside down. I had my foot up around his butthole. I was inverted. My arm was outstretched and he just sprawled on me and my back went snap, snap, snap. Well, how do I fix myself? And the physio looks at you like, are you an alien? What's wrong with you? Just stop doing whatever you're doing. Now you do jiu-jitsu. You're like, no, I'm not stopping. Just help me.
And the physio is trying to like fit that into their categorization of, oh yeah, jiu-jitsu, taekwondo, aikido. Yeah, I've seen it. You do the thing.
Taibo.
Yeah, dojo life. You know, they're like, they just don't get that grind and that pressure and that, and just the amount of force that's applied to the most random of positions that are completely non-replicable.
Yep.
You know, like it's just so fucking random, the whole thing, that unless they've done it or they've watched it for a long time, they really got no idea.
They don't get it. Yeah. No. And it's very hard to find a jiu-jitsu savvy therapist, practitioner. And look, there's also a gray area, and this is where I feel this is what we've worked on in the last kind of 2.5 years, 3 years, is the gray area between when you've had an injury or you've got a chronic thing that you haven't fixed because we're just being humans, just soldiering on, and where you're healthy and fit and you're more or less pain-free and you're feeling good. And that gray area is recovery. But how do you go from like not quite completely fucked to back to healthy? And I think a lot of what I've seen in terms of what we're doing in terms of prehab, rehab. I mean, we're not physiotherapists, but we know that
we should be.
We should be. Just hand me a degree. I mean, Craig Jones can get a yellow belt off one throw in a tournament. I've rehabbed a lot of people from injuries. Just give me a degree. What can I tell you?
He got a judo yellow belt for that hip toss.
I mean, Dante Leon's a hard guy to take down, but he's kind of short.
It's a mad hip toss.
Craig is very tall. He's very photogenic. Having also been through my own process with physios and torn ligaments and also having to work it out for myself, I feel like what we can do is just go, hey, let's save you some time. Like, don't do a whole lot of this. Don't do a whole lot of that. Let's just give you what will work for you and bring you back to a point where you can get back on the mats and start your path back to being healthy. And I guess that kind of brings us back to the Bulletproof kind of method or process, because people always ask us different questions and really it's all about strength and mobility. And I guess I'll get you to speak on that a little bit more, Joseph.
Okay, yeah. So strength and mobility, two kind of specific things that we're interested in. The big one that people ask about a lot, and this will sort of frame where I'm going with this, people ask about conditioning.
Yes.
Right? And everyone's said this. I just need more cardio. I need more gas, right? And it's like, because you finish a round and you are fatigued and gasping for air. And so the initial, like the connection is, I'm fatigued, I'm gasping for air, I need a bigger gas tank.
Yes.
Right? It's a simple formula to kind of see how people arrive at that. And the thing that we're saying is like, well, what if you look at this from a different perspective? And that perspective is one of movement efficiency. And so what we're talking about there is your ability to move through dynamic positions for a reasonable period of time let's say you're doing a 6 minute round. Now, the stronger, the more mobile, the more coordinated, the more agile you are, the less energy it takes you to navigate those movements over 6-7 minutes, right? But if you got super tight hip flexors, your spine doesn't work properly, your shoulders are fucked, you can't get it up and off the ground without a huge amount of effort, then that 6 or 7 minutes is going to be really fucking hard on you, right? It's going to cost you a lot of energy.
Yes.
And this is the thing for us is like, I mean, we dabble with a bit of conditioning. I haven't done any conditioning training for years now because it's not of interest to me. Jiu-jitsu is my conditioning.
Yes.
In the gym, that's where I work on my efficiency, yes. Getting stronger, getting more mobile, and that allows me to flow through. So I can still be a savage when I have to be super explosive, but it also means I'm not like burning up needless energy for fucking minutes on end, right? Yeah. The thing that we noticed with the majority of these jiu-jitsu folk is that they just move like shit.
Yes.
They're really good when they're on their back or when they're, you know, like they have their jiu-jitsu technique, that's great, but they don't have good body mechanics. They're not expressing full range of motion. They're missing simple things like hip flexor mobility, spinal rotation, their shoulders are super tight.
Yes.
So the lowest hanging fruit, when we look at it, knowing what we know and with all the people we've worked with, the lowest hanging fruit is, well, let's fix those fucking glaring issues first.
Mm.
And then once there's an adequate amount of efficiency, all right, then we can start to work on the gas tank, whatever.
Yes.
But I think people notice by the time, oh shit, man, I'm moving so much better.
Yes.
I feel fitter on the mats already. That's not even a consideration anymore.
Yeah. And I think also the thing, there's a couple elements here. I'm with you 100% on all those things. Pain is a neural inhibitor. So you can't, if you're in pain, you can't be strong. Like, that's your body blocking your ability to use your nervous system. And a lot of jiu-jitsu folk are in pain, but we just grin and bear it, right? Because like, that's jiu-jitsu, that's the mentality. But in truth, if you can take the handbrake off, which is pain, someone will be stronger and they don't have to lift any weights. You've just freed them up. Like, I think it was a funny thing with kind of isolation. People stopped training jiu-jitsu for a couple of months. People like feeling, dang, I'm feeling good.
Oh, through COVID?
You know?
Yeah. Injuries have healed up.
Yeah, man, I'm so healed.
Yeah.
So strange.
I actually slept last week for the first time.
Amazing. But I think relative to that idea of efficiency, strength is a much greater component of jiu-jitsu than people probably account for. And we all know that feeling when you're rolling someone who's about your size, but they're far stronger than you. You're like, I can't do anything. Like, that isometric strength is a much bigger component of grappling than, say, strength endurance is, say, for boxing or other combat sports.
Yep.
And then also, we all know what it's like to roll with someone who's super flexible. Like, they can get their guard from anywhere. You're, like, bending their arm inside out. They're not tapping. You're like, what is going on here?
Yeah.
There's no restriction. So they're moving exceptionally well. The combination of both those things. If you've got someone who's strong and flexible, that's like a jiu-jitsu nightmare.
It's the worst.
It's the hardest thing to deal with. And I think if we look at this more from the perspective of somebody who's like, oh, I do jiu-jitsu, if we can add a degree of strength and movement efficiency, jiu-jitsu life gets easier.
Yes.
Not only can you control you better, you can control your opponent better. And also when you're more flexible, you've got more to play with. You're not tapping off bad posture.
Like, that's right.
You haven't got bench press posture and you're kimuraing yourself. You know, you can move out of things. And also it acts as the process, I feel, because this is the thing that, you know, dealing with the Bulletproof BJJ community and all our lovely people on the program, shout out to all our Bulletproof BJJ crew. People are saying, I feel better. I can actually train more. And actually, we've had some pretty good weight loss stories because people were just able to train more jiu-jitsu, which meant they burnt more energy and then lost weight.
Yeah.
So that was never a goal, but that was
beautiful side product.
Great side product.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I like to think of you think of the human body, you think of someone that's really tight through their major joints.
Mm.
Your joints are really, the hinges that allow you to move. So if you can only express, let's say, 50% of the range of motion in a particular joint,
yeah,
you've essentially reduced your movement capacity by 50%.
Yes.
Right. And if you look at pro bodybuilders, they're a great example of this. There's a lot of interesting little stories about what happens to them in later life.
Yes.
Because they train themselves into this rigidity, right?
It's
part of their specialization in that sport. But the what happens in the end is you actually become a prisoner of your own body.
Yes.
You can't move.
Yes.
That's it. You're fucking locked in behind all this muscle. Mm. And you know, and I'm not saying that there's a correlation necessarily between building muscle and getting tight, but for those guys, there is. So for jiu-jitsu folks, it's like all these fucking benefits cascade out of them becoming stronger and more mobile. It's like weight loss, energy, better sleep, better movement on the mats, better gas tank. Like it's like purely by focusing on a couple of high level things.
Yes.
Right? You get all this stuff.
Yeah, it flows down.
Whereas if we're all just like smashing you with cardio,
yeah,
sure, maybe you're going to get a little bit fitter. Maybe you gain 5% capacity there.
But you're no less likely to get injured. Like you, no. If not more.
And it's not going to give you any other benefits.
No.
It's going to help that one little thing a small degree.
Yeah, it doesn't have the crossover. Yeah, no, I feel that. And I guess that's where that Joe came up with the hashtag some days pour harder, which I think is very apt because really we're not asking people to do a lot more. We're just asking people to do enough.
And we're not saying be a pussy.
No, not at all. Not in the slightest. I think it's more around the idea that you see a lot of people, you know, come off the mat and they're like, throw a gi over a chin-up bar and just do some gi chin-ups. But ask yourself, like, that's actually not the best thing you need to do straight after training. You probably need to just do some stretches. If you want to come in the next day and do it all over again, you need to look after your rig. Like we've got to do some body maintenance. And I feel like that's in the fine print. Like no one says, hey, you want to do this martial art? Look, you're going to suck for at least 5 years, contract at least 6 major injuries, and you're probably still not going to be very good.
Like, and no, you got to stretch every day.
Yeah, I mean, no one's signing up for that. And then if someone also said to you, oh yeah, by the way, you also have to do a subsequent amount of like 2 to 5 hours body maintenance a day, like a week, also people wouldn't necessarily sign up for that. But once you're in, you're part of the jiu-jitsu cult and you want it and you're on the path to black belt, we all want to see everybody get there. But we don't want everyone to be a crippled, old, you know, sensei guy who can't do anything, like get to black belt and then can't do anything.
Which is the classic black belt model.
It is.
This is, you know, the simplest thing you can do is look at your peers in your class, look at the older guys and girls who've been on the mats for a long time, usually got a black belt or a brown belt, something like that, and ask yourself, do they have the kind of body mechanics that I wish I could have?
Yeah.
And I can guarantee you the vast majority of them, you will say, fuck no, I don't want to end up like that.
I don't want to move like my grandpa when I'm 35.
My bro, we're approaching endpoint.
Cool.
Well, tell me any final thoughts.
Well, I'm excited because we're going to be doing this so much more often. And anyone who wants to kind of get on board with Bulletproof and is hearing this can go to our Instagram at Bulletproof for BJJ on Instagram. But then also if people want to check us out online and really hear what goes behind it and have a look at our program and how they can benefit from it, go to www.bulletproofforbjj.com. And then, yeah, look forward to more of this. Also, if you just want to reach out to Joey or myself, we're very accessible. You can find me on Facebook, James Tenacity Tomlinson, and you, J-Bone.
Find me on Instagram at JBJoey, JBJoey.
Yeah.
But we run the Instagram account, so you can get at us through that. On our website, take a free trial of the program. If you want to sign up, use the code BULLETPROOF10 and you'll get yourself a 10% discount as well.
Nice. All right. Awesome. Well, I'm very much looking forward to doing this again. And getting into more subject matter on how we can help y'all be more bulletproof.
Thanks for listening, guys. Cheers, JT.
My man. Thanks, Joey.